Hello everybody, today I am going to deliver my third lecture on bridge engineering, and it consists of maximum flood discharge, which is very essential for the bridge hydraulics and the IRC bridge loading. Okay, so first we will discuss regarding maximum flood discharge and how it is calculated. Okay, maximum flood discharge is calculated by basically two different methods. First method is from past record available, if any, or the discharge observed at any nearby site. It is very simple. The engineer who is going to carry out the bridge hydraulics has to inquire the villagers regarding the past record of flood, and also if such a record is not available, then he should observe the discharge at the nearby site to calculate the maximum flood discharge or to know what is the maximum flood discharge. And second method is from rainfall and other catchment area characteristics, and there are four methods available. First is empirical method, second is rational method, third is area velocity method, and fourth is unit hydrograph method. We can remember by this simple word, engineer AU. ER is the short form of engineer, and AU, you know that, AU. So, E means empirical method, R means rational method, AU ka A means area velocity method, and U means unit hydrograph method. It is very simple to remember, engineer AU, okay. Then we will discuss about what is the empirical method. Empirical method is not a direct method because it is measured by formulas. So, this is the indirect method of determining the maximum flood discharge. In this method, area of catchment or basin is mainly considered. All the basin and stream characteristics are merged in a constant. So there are different formulas, empirical formulas. First is the Dickens formula. What is the Dickens formula? Dickens formula is Q is equal to C into bracket A raised to 3 by 4, where A, sometimes it is called as M also, is the area in kilometer square or square kilometer. It is the catchment area. How it is calculated? It is calculated by experienced engineer through topo sheet. We must obtain the topographical sheets and see how the water is contributed towards the bridge site, and we have to fix that area. That area to be fixed by very experienced engineer. Then what is Q? Q is the discharge in meter cube per second. And what is the values of C, or what is the values of that C constant? In areas where rainfall is 60 to 120 centimeter, the C is taken as 11 to 14. In Madhya Pradesh, it is taken as 14 to 19. And in Western Ghats of Maharashtra, it is taken as a 32. Why it is 32? Because Western Ghats have more rain. Then second is the Ravish formula, or Ravish formula. It is Q, C, A raised to 2 by 3. Similar to Dickens formula. In Dickens formula, A raised to 3 by 4. But in Ravish formula, Q is equal to C, A raised to 2 by 3. Then there is another formula basically used in PWDs and irrigation where bridge construction is there. That is English formula. That English formula is used in state of Maharashtra. And what is that formula? Q is equal to 4350 M divided by into bracket M plus 10.40 raised to 1 by 2 or under root of M plus 10.40. Where what is M? M is equal to A, as stated earlier also. It is the catchment area in kilometer square. Okay, and all other things are the constant. But you must know the area which is obtained from the topographical sheets. Okay. Then second method is rational method. Rational method is also indirect method of determining the maximum flood discharge. And rational method is applicable for small pipe culverts only. And what is the formula for that determining the maximum flood discharge is Q is equal to 0.028 PFAIC, where Q is equal to discharge or runoff in meter cube per second, P is percentage coefficient of runoff, A is catchment area in hectares, and IC is critical intensity of rainfall in centimeter per hour, and F is equal to coefficient of distribution of rainfall. You must remember this formula and get all the other things from various handbooks of civil engineering and calculate the maximum flood discharge by this rational method. Then we will discuss about the area velocity method, which is very important method and all the time used. It is combination of direct and indirect method, because area is calculated directly, so it is direct, and sometimes velocity is calculated by indirect methods, but sometimes the velocity is calculated by direct method also, so it may be treated as a direct method of calculation of maximum flood discharge. Then we will proceed towards how would you calculate the area of mean flood section. What is mean flood section? That is very important. We have to take the mean of three sections, and that mean of three sections is the mean flood section. Then how we calculate this area? First of all, you must know the high flood level, which is discussed in our earlier chapters. That level of high flood level is found out and marked. Then three cross sections are selected. This is very important. One at proposed bridge site, one kilometer ahead of upstream, and another 1 kilometer below the downstream. These are the three cross sections selected. The level of the river bed is found out by surveying equipments, and depth is calculated by sounding rod, and they are plotted by scale. Okay. Then area of cross section up to HFL. Please must remember, area of cross section up to HFL can be worked out, and average of three areas. Which three areas average? At the bridge site, second area 1 kilometer ahead upstream, and third area is 1 kilometer below downstream. So average of three areas is called as a mean flood section. That area of mean flood section we have to calculate. Okay. Then what is the discharge? Discharge is area into velocity. Then we are already determined the area or area of mean flood section. Then how you would calculate the velocity? There are some empirical formulas also and some direct methods also. What are these empirical formulas? First important equation is Chase's equation, which is V is equal to C into bracket R S raised to 1/2, or V is equal to C into square root of R S. Then what is the V? V is the mean velocity in meter per second, and C is equal to Chase's constant, and Chase's constant is calculated by two different formulas. First formula is Cutter's formula, and second formula is Bazin's formula. What is Cutter's formula? Cutter's formula is C is equal to 23 plus 0.00155 divided by S plus 1 divided by N whole divided by 1 plus into bracket 23 plus 0.00155 divided by S bracket complete and outside the bracket N divided by under root M or R. Okay, where N is equal to, what is the N? N is the coefficient of roughness, and which is the value of coefficient of roughness ranges from 0.025 to 0.15 depending upon the nature of surface of bed and sides. What is R or M? R or M is the hydraulic mean depth. Hydraulic mean depth, how it is calculated? Area divided by perimeter or P in meter. S is equal to slope per kilometer length, that is the slope of that river bed or slope of that stream bed. Okay. Then another formula to calculate the value of C is Bazin's formula. What is the Bazin's formula? Bazin's formula is C is equal to 157.60 whole divided by 1 plus N divided by under root R, where R is equal to hydraulic mean depth, that is sometimes may be termed as a small m. Then another formula to determining the velocity is very important in hydraulics, and we all the time calculate the formula by this Manning's or Manning's equation or Manning's formula. What is that Manning's formula? V is equal to 1 divided by N R raised to 2 by 3 S raised to 1 by 2. It is very important formula. You people must remember that V is equal to 1 by N R raised to 2 by 3 S raised to 1/2. Okay. Then these are indirect methods to calculate the velocity. Then how you will calculate the velocity by direct observations? For direct observations, two cables stretched across the stream at 15 to 30 meter apart. Okay. The width of the river is divided into suitable number of compartments by hanging pendants. Okay. Then mean velocity of river flow is determined by using surface plot, subsurface plot, velocity rod or current meter. These are the four: surface plot, subsurface plot, velocity rod or current meter. These are the equipments used to measure the velocity by direct method. Then floats and velocity rods are allowed to travel from one section to another section. Two cables are spaced at a distance of 15 to 30 meter apart on a river stream or on a bridge site, where we have to calculate the maximum flood discharge. And in between these two compartments, or in between these two cables, we have to calculate the velocity. Okay, what is the velocity? Velocity is the distance, that distance traveled by the float, or what is the distance and in what time it is traveled. We have to calculate that time also. Then velocity is, we know that distance upon time, and we have to calculate the velocity accordingly. That floats or velocity rods are allowed to travel from one section to another section. Okay, and that velocity is calculated in each compartment, and time taken to cover the distance is noted. In between that two cables, there is a river, and that river is divided into, or stream is divided into the compartments, and we have to calculate the velocity in each of these compartments, and we have to find out it by the mean velocity. How the mean velocity is calculated? That summation of all the velocities, all these compartments. If we divided that stream into the six compartments, then velocity V1, V2, V3, V4, V6, we have to add that algebraically, and divided by 6, we obtain the mean velocity of that stream. Okay. It is illustrated in this figure. In this figure, this is one cable, and another cable is placed at a distance 15 to 30 meter apart, and the river stream is divided into the six compartment A1, A2, A3, A4, A5 and A6. And in each compartment, we have to calculate the velocity. How the velocity is calculated? With the help of surface float, subsurface float, velocity rod or current meter. And how it is calculated? We have to calculate the distance traveled by these floats and divided by time taken by this float to reach from one compartment to another compartment. It is very simple, and we have to calculate the velocity by direct observations. You must remember this figure also. This figure is very important. We have to draw such figures in descriptive type of examinations of diploma and degree, as well as sometimes it occurs in the mains of MPSC and UPSC also. Okay, then we will proceed for further. Okay. What is the surface float? Is the float having a diameter varies from 8 centimeter to 16 centimeter. Okay. 18 to 8 to 6. Okay. And it consisting of light material such as a cork or driftwood. ये surface float जो होता है वो wooden material का होता है. This material used for surface and surface float is made up of cork or a driftwood. You must remember that. This is the surface float at the top of that HFL, and sometimes it is connected by subsurface float. And what subsurface float may be a hollow metal sphere. And what is the depth of that hollow metal sphere from the river bed? It is located at 0.2 of capital D. What is the capital D? Capital D is the HFL. Okay. This is the velocity, another figure. It shows the velocity rod to calculate the, which is used to calculate the velocity by direct observations. And this, what is surface float? I already explained. Lighter surface float is attached by a cord to a hollow metal sphere. Surface float is attached to the hollow metal sphere acting as a subsurface float. And this is the figure showing the current meter. Current meter is placed in the direction of flow to measure the velocity. It is going to measure first is the distance traveled, and second is the time, and by dividing the distance is divided by time, then you will get the velocity of flow. Okay. Then last method is unit hydrograph method. Hydrograph is basically studied in detail in water resources engineering or hydrology. Hydrograph is the graph of discharge versus time. A hydrograph is prepared by direct calculations or by direct methods as well as indirect methods. This method is developed by Sherman and Schneider. The unit hydrograph is derived from flood hydrograph. So first we have to derive the flood hydrograph, or we have to draw the flood hydrograph, and from flood hydrograph we have to derive the unit hydrograph, and from that unit hydrograph you will get the discharge. Okay. This is the figure which shows the unit hydrograph. On the y-axis, discharge is plotted. On x-axis, time is plotted. And there are various terms also. What is the rising limb? What is the inflection point? What is the recession curve? You must study the same in detail in water resources engineering. Okay, then we'll proceed further. This is very big chapter, IRC bridge loading, but I am going to explain you in very brief method or very briefly, because detailed calculations for that you have to go to design section of bridge engineering. So I prepared these notes from examination point of view, so you will know what is generally that type of loading and what is the use of that loading. I am not going to elaborate you in detail, okay, but I am going to elaborate you or explain you for examination point of view. Then what is the first loading? Actually, first loading is IRC class 70R loading, that is a heavy loading. But for bridge, we consider three types of loading. First loading is IRC class AA loading. This loading corresponds to class 70 loading and based upon the original classification methods of defense authorities. Defense authority ne jo develop kiya hai bridge loading ki methods, uske upar ye IRC class AA loading depend hai. What is the use of this IRC class AA loading? This loading is adopted in municipal limits, in contemplated industrial areas and along the national as well as state highways. And following types of vehicles are specified in this IRC class A loading. First is a tracked vehicle, which is used for military purposes, and second is the wheeled vehicles, which are used for transportations of various goods. This loading is checked for IRC class A loading. Even though this is higher loading, it is checked for IRC class A loading because this loading may cause higher stresses than IRC class A loading. So we have to check this loading to IRC class A loading. Okay. This is the figure which shows you the tracked vehicle also and wheeled vehicle also. Tracked vehicle having a load of 350 kN acting through their tracks, and this loading is specially used for two-lane carriageway having a width of 7.5 meter carriageway width. Okay, and in second figure we in figure B there are wheeled vehicle for rear end for front and rear wheels, the load of 37.5 kN is acting, and from intermediate wheels the load of 62.5 kN is acting, and we have to calculate the loading and calculations of shear force and bending moment diagram according to these loadings. Okay, or influence line diagram also. What is the IRC class A loading? Various types of axle load and axle spacings are considered to cover different vehicles using the road. So IRC class A loading is not based upon two type of vehicles, but it is depends upon the various types of axle load and axle spacing in various types of vehicles. This type of loading is exclusively used for analysis of all types of lorries made in all the countries of the world. So all different types of lorries are considered in this type of loading. And this load train, for loading there is a load train which consists of driving unit and two trailers. One driving unit and two trailers are considered. And what is the use of this IRC class A loading? This type of loading is used for design of all types of permanent bridges and culverts on all roads. Okay. What is the IRC class B loading? This type of loading is similar to class A loading, but reduced axle load and tire contact dimensions. Means in IRC class A loading, axle load is more, but in IRC class B loading, axle load is less, and also tire contact dimensions are also less. This loading is adopted for temporary structures and bridges in specified areas. Okay. And this is the figure for IRC class A loading. Wheel type of vehicle is considered. This is one lorry or one driving unit, and these are the two trailers. And such a train is considered for the loading on the bridge. Okay. Then forces acting on the bridge. There are one short note. What are the different types of forces acting on the bridge? So we have to write all these type of forces shortly or briefly in mains. Okay, first is the dead load. You must know that what is the dead load. It is the load of superstructure and substructure, and that is that self weight of bridge. Then second is the live load. How we calculate the live load? I already explained you earlier that various types of IRC class A loading, class A loading, class B loading. Which particular type of loading is used, that loading is considered as a live load acting on that bridge. Then impact loading or dynamic effect of live load. Impact loading means when the vehicles are moving, it causes sometimes impact on the road. This impact loading is based on certain percentage of live load or certain fraction of live load. Okay. Then wind load is also acting on the bridge. Then horizontal forces due to water current. Then longitudinal forces due to braking of vehicle or tractive effort. Then centrifugal force when bridge is located on curve. Whenever there is a curve, there is an effect of centrifugal force. Then buoyancy due to water, the force of buoyancy is acting on the bridge. Then earth pressure, because abutments are and wing walls are retaining certain earth, and that earth exerts the pressure on the bridge. Then deformation stresses, temperature stresses, erection stresses, and secondary stresses. And the last one is seismic and earthquake forces. These 14 types of, generally not 14, there are too many loading acting, too many different types of loads acting on the bridge. But we have to write at least these 14 type of different type of forces acting on the bridge. So we will go fastly: dead load, live load, impact load, wind load, horizontal force due to water current, longitudinal force due to tractive effort or braking of vehicle, centrifugal force, buoyancy, earth pressure, deformation stresses, temperature stresses, erection stresses, secondary stresses, and seismic and earthquake forces. Okay. Then what is the IRC recommendation for wind load on bridges? Wind load is acting horizontally on the area. Horizontally, it is acting on horizontally, not vertically. It is acting horizontally on the area where resultant stresses are maximum. And for deck and through bridges, what is deck bridge? Floor is supported on the top of superstructure. That is deck bridge. And what is through bridge? When floor is supported on bottom of superstructure. And the values are calculated by different methods. One, for ordinary highway bridge, it is 300 kg per meter that wind load is acting. And for highway bridge with tramway, it is 450 kg per meter. Okay. You must remember these values to write MCQs also. What is the impact load? I already explained, it is the fraction of live load. According to IRC, impact load is calculated by the increment of live load by impact allowance or impact fraction for RCC bridge. And that impact fraction, how it is calculated for RCC bridge, it is 4.5 divided whole divided by 6 plus L. And for steel bridge, it is 9 divided by 13.5 plus L, where L is the length of the bridge, which is varies from 3 meter to 45 meter. Okay. And what is the percentage increase in live load due to impact? It generally 25%. And for spans less than 3 meter and more than 45 meter, it is calculated by using curves. Okay. So impact factor is depending upon the span of bridge. Okay. Seismic load. Seismic load. Some nowadays earthquakes are occurring in each and every part of India. So this seismic load have a great importance for designing of bridges. How it is calculated, I explained it briefly. This load is considered in the locality which is likely to be affected by earthquake. Then necessary allowance is made in the design of bridge. Seismic load is considered as also horizontal force, like a wind load. It is considered as a horizontal force equal to certain percentage of self weight of structure. And maximum percentage of self weight of structure taken as 12.5% of self weight of structure. And this force is acting, this force is not acting horizontally, this force is acting in any direction through the center of gravity of that structure. That is very important. That force is acting in any direction through the CG. That is very important. Then forces due to water current. Water current also horizontal force. This horizontal force acting on the bridge submerged in the running water. This force on the pier parallel to the direction of water is calculated by P is equal to 52 kV square. That is formula, simple. We have to remember that P is equal to 52 kV square, where P is equal to intensity of pressure due to water current in kg per meter square, V is equal to velocity of current or a stream in meter per second, and K is the constant which depends upon the shape of pier. It varies from 0.45 to 1.5. When current strikes on the pier, when the water flow or current strikes on the pier at an angle, if it is not strikes in a right angle but at certain different angle, that velocity is to be resolved in the two components. One component is horizontal and another component is vertical, because it is inclined force. You must remember that. Okay. And for more details and notes, please contact our administrator. You can may take the screenshot. My email ID is there. You may contact me. Okay. And my next lecture is on different component parts of the bridge structure. That is very important. You must know what is the abutment, you must know what is the pier, you must know what is the wing walls, you must know the different types of foundations, which is useful for foundation engineering also. You must know the cofferdam. We will discuss that in my upcoming lectures. So please don't miss my upcoming lectures, and please subscribe me, and also please press the like button if you like this lecture from examination point of view. Thank you. Good night. Bye bye. Bye. Okay.